Let me start recording, otherwise it'll happen like the other day. Which I don't want to. So I'm making doubly sure, have I started or not? Yes, I am recording. It is very heartening to know 2-3 people come to class and nobody checks the videos on YouTube. And I'm just thinking, I've been putting it as unlisted, which means only those people to whom I send the link can see it. Thinking of making them public, at least somebody who is interested may see it. If I leave them as unlisted, then nobody is seeing them, so why put them at all? And I don't have this fear that I'm talking rubbish and I don't want the world to know about it. So I don't mind putting it. Yeah. So we had finished, we were doing Dharma, and we had finished Varna Dharma and Ashrama Dharma. Now let's pick up one of the most important aspects of Dharma, which is Raja Dharma. Now you must understand that Raja Dharma actually comes in the time when the Janapadas were becoming Mahajanapadas, and they were also becoming monarchies, or they were becoming empires and kingdom. Till then, Rajadharma was not spoken of. It was mentioned, but it wasn't spoken of so much. People started talking about Rajadharma when the Janapadas became Mahajanapadas first, and as empires like the Nanda Empire, and then followed by the Mauryan Empire, when that happened. And of course, if you look at the Shatavahana Empire, the huge empire, nobody talks about Shatavahana Empire. It was a very, very big empire. And I don't know if I have ever told you this, that the word Andhra actually doesn't come from here. Neither does the language Telugu come from where we are in, we say, two Telugu states, Telangana and Andhra Pradesh. This Andhra and Telugu don't come from this region. Okay, they come from a valley that lies between Pune and Mumbai. So if you're ever traveling by train, after you cross Lonavala, you will find that there'll be a big board. I don't know if it is still there. I haven't traveled by train for quite some time. It's called the Andhra Valley Power Corporation. That is where the Andhra people came from. Okay. And the language that they spoke was also called Andhra Bhasha, or it was called Tenugu, T-E-N-U-G-U, but pronounced Ana, Tenugu, which over time got perverted to Telugu. So this was a Telugu empire, but it had its roots not here, but in the Andhra Valley, and the Shatavahanas were the dynasty, and their first big emperor was Shalivahana. Shalivahana was the one who went around conquering, and interestingly enough, I don't know if you're aware of this, the Shatavahana dynasty went almost up to Agra. Okay, and down south it went, it came to this area, to parts of Karnataka, almost up to where the Vijayanagara Empire is today and all that. And since I keep talking about the fact that, you know, the Kshatriyas were supposed to be kings, the idea of, I mean, not the idea, the Shatavahana Empire was basically a Brahmin empire. It was a very big empire. And then you will see that there were other empires like the Rashtrakuta Empire that went all over Kerala, Tamil Nadu, parts of what is today Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, Maharashtra. The Rashtrakuta Empire again was a huge empire. The Cholas were conquerors. They went to Singapore, named it Simhapuri, and that got perverted to Singapore. But otherwise it's Simhapuri. And it was Rajaraja Chola who did this. And the construction of huge, magnificent structures of temples and all were done by these empires. And most of these were Brahmin empires. The two Shudra empires in the south were the Kakatiya empire, the Kakatiya dynasty, and the Vijayanagara empire. That also, which was Hampi, that particular empire was also a Shudra empire. So that tells you that this caste system that we talk about as lacking in mobility, this, that, all that is up to a certain stage acceptable, but it is not a complete history that has been written properly. So as kingdoms emerged, as they became empires, occupied vast territories, then there was obviously a necessity for administration. Okay, and please remember that in India, we don't have anything called politics, first and foremost. Okay, people will tell you that ancient Indian state and government, there was governance, but there was no government. Governance is a process. Okay, government are institutions. We don't have institutions. We didn't have institutions like the legislature, judiciary, all these things. State didn't exist at all. State in even in Europe is a modern thing. It came to India through the colonial this thing, and it became a proper colonial state in the 19th century and became an independent state in 1947. So, and we didn't have anything called the police, P-O-L-I-S. We didn't have something like that. So we didn't have anything political. And every aspect of human life was governed by this overarching structure called Sanatana Dharma. Sanatana Dharma was this thing that is an overarching structure. What is Sanatana Dharma? Okay, Sanatana, basically, some people will tell you that it is Sada Nutana, which is always new. Sada is always, Nutana is new. But this is complete rubbish. Okay, it doesn't mean that. Sanatana is a Sanskrit word which basically means unchanging. Okay, dharma is dharma. Right? Wherever there is dharma, life is good, people live happily, people live comfortably. But if dharma doesn't exist, then there is a problem. People don't have good quality of life. So it was up to the king, the Raja. In the Janapadas, there were no Rajas. The Mahajanapadas, some kind of Raja started coming, but it is with the empires that the Rajas came. And it became imperative for the Rajas basically to understand the concept of dharma, and they had to be trained. Okay, they had to be trained in the art of governance, the art of governance, because they had to govern dharmically, which means as per the rules of dharma. So a king had to be educated in the dharma shastras. Okay, there are dharma shastra is a word, but there are, like I told you, there are different kinds of dharmas. Okay, and I've only given you five of them here for a reason. And you have to understand that they had to have this vichakshana. The other day I told you the quality to distinguish between what is good and what is not good. The righteous, good as righteous. Okay, the correct thing to do. This is something that you find in Rajadharma. And this had to be imparted as education to kings. So if you take even the epics, the itihasas like Ramayana, Mahabharata, all these will tell you that Rama and his brothers, then in the Mahabharata, the Pandavas and the Kauravas, all of them went to different ashramas. They went to gurus. Okay. And while they were living in the ashrama of the guru, they had to follow the rules and regulations of the ashrama like any other ordinary student. Any other ordinary student who is there. So they were our old Gurukul. See, today you find this word Gurukul. Okay, it is not Kul. It is Gurukulam in Sanskrit. If you like, you can call it Gurukula, but it is Gurukulam. Okay, and unfortunately, in the Telugu language, we translate Kulam into caste. Okay, Meedi Ekulamu, they will ask. That is not a correct thing. Kulamu is a community, not a caste. I told you, the caste is a closed group. It does not allow other people to enter, and it does not allow people in that caste to leave it. Right? So that it's a closed group. But a Gurukulam or a Gurukula was a community of students studying under a particular guru. The gurus were different kinds of sages. By sage, I mean a wise person, S-A-G-E, sage, somebody who knew the Dharma Shastras, somebody who knew the other aspects like the Vedas, the Vedangas, the Upavedas, all those. The guru had to know all these things, and people went for Vidya, which is education, to the guru, and that became the Gurukulam. And even the kings, irrespective of what Varna they came from, like I said, they could have been Shudras, they could have been Brahmins, irrespective of whoever they were, they had to follow the same rules. And there is also a minor thing in the Dharma Shastras, which is an instruction to the guru how to specifically educate a future king. Okay, when these people, when they went to the Gurukulam, they went as children. So they would become kings in the future. So there is, in the Dharma Shastras, there is this little bit of an instruction to the guru, basically telling him how to educate a future king. So a future king had a little bit of extra education in what came to be called Rajadharma. Okay, what came to be called Rajadharma. Let me give you a very simple example. Okay, if you ask a modern feminist, they'll say this is bunkum. There was this lady called Malladi Subbamma who denounced the Ramayana, denounced the Mahabharata, denounced all of them and said these are all rubbish, patriarchal texts. You know, all kinds of nonsense she spoke. You have to go with the idea that these are all historical ideas. Even if the Ramayana and Mahabharata didn't actually happen, they were written in a time of history when there were certain concerns which are considered to be absolutely necessary in terms of their being fulfilled. So if we're looking at the idea of Rajadharma, it is best exemplified by Rama. Okay, now Rama, I say it is best exemplified by Rama, because you see that for Rama, there is no distinction. When you understand the character of Rama, you'll see that there is no distinction between that which is personal and that which is public. There's no distinction. So the first time you will find it is when he's asked to go for Vanavasa, okay, by his father at because of the demand made by the father, by Kaikeyi, she said he has to go to 14-year Vanavasa, and Bharata, her son, had to become the king. Okay. The interesting thing here is, that's why I put this Pitru Pautra. I'll come to that a little later. I won't expand on them much more because I am talking about them now. Now, if you look at the Rajadharma that was given to as instruction to Rama included his Pautra Dharma. Pautra is the dharma of a son. Okay? Putra. So when it becomes dharma, they don't say putra dharma, it is pautra dharma. Sandhi, grammar. So, even though he was a king, he was also governed by pautra dharma in the sense that he had to follow what his father asked him to do. His father said, you have to go to one of us. You can also see that Lakshmana basically believed that it was his dharma to accompany his brother and wife to the forest to be there for them as protection. And further still, if you look at it, Bharata, okay, Bharata, who was supposed to be crowned as a king, he did not accept the kingship. He did not accept the kingship. What he did was that he went and asked Rama for his padukas. Padukas are made of wood. Okay, they are made of wood and footwear. He put them on his head because he said Rama is the elder brother. He put the padukas on the throne and ruled as Rama would have ruled. So here you will see that the personal and the public are becoming one. This is the first instance. The second instance that you see, when Sita is taken away by Ravana, despite the fact that Ravana took her by force. Okay? Ravana did not touch her. Ravana did not touch her because she did not consent to it. And that is why he gave her time. He said, you think about it, you marry me. Okay? He gave her time. And she refused to be inside the palace. So she was in the Ashokavana. Ashokavana is Shoka, is grief. Ashoka is no grief. She took it as her personal dharma to not be in the dwelling of someone else. So she lived in the Ashokavana and Ravana never touched her. That is when we say Asura and Rakshasa, you know, it is like Ravana touched her. No, he didn't touch her at all. Okay, and that is why the Ramayana says, Ravana was such a learned man. His only mistake in life is Sita Paharana, or taking Sita away. When he died, Ravana Kashta in Sanskrit, Kashta basically is the body. When it was cremated, it burnt for 28 days. Okay? It burnt for 28 days because he was somebody who followed Raja Dharma. And when Rama takes Sita, he says, I have full faith in you, but the world should know that you are pure. Okay? That you haven't been touched. He said, I know, but the world should know. And that's why Sita had to undergo Agni Pariksha. Agni, fire, is that which purifies. Okay? And there is a reason why we cremate bodies in India. There are a few communities within so-called Hinduism that bury their people. But if you go by the Vedic and Upanishadic things, you will find that cremation is advised. Why? Because the body is Panchabhuta. Bhuta is not ghost. Okay? Panchabhutas are air, water, sky, earth, okay, all these, fire, these are panchabhutas. And when you consign a body to this, the panchabhutas that came together to keep this body as one, they disperse again and go back to becoming air, water, all those. Okay, so that is the panchabhutas. So, Agni is therefore sacred because it has the power to purify. So, Sita had to undergo that test. And when she walked through it, Agni did not burn her, which basically means that she was chaste, she was not touched by Ravana. Okay. This is the second instance. The third instance in Rama's life. You know the story of the dhobi. One lady goes and somewhere and comes, and a drunk dhobi says, I doubt your purity. And I am not a stupid fellow like Rama to accept somebody who has been elsewhere as my wife. So you get out of the house. Okay. And as per Raja Dharma, the kings sent different people unknown to the public that these were agents of the king. They always tried to take feedback about what people are saying about the king. What are they saying about how the king is ruling? Okay, so these people are actually those who brought feedback to the kings about public opinion. So today we talk about public opinion as if it's a big thing. But public opinion was a big thing in those days as well. And so these people were used. And when Rama came to know that somebody said this. Then he said, I have not set a good example. And therefore, he sent Sita away to the ashrama of Valmiki. He sent her to the and again he said, I am not doing this because I do not believe in you. You have even passed the Agni Pariksha. But as a Raja, I have to basically set an example to my people. If as a Raja, I am setting a wrong example to my people, then I am not a good king. Good here is moral. Okay, I'm not a good king. So Rama sends Sita away. So if you look at this, and the fact that it was important for the kings to understand, it was very important for the kings to understand what people were saying about their rules, and that is why they had these people who mingled with everyone. They didn't know that these were appointed by the king. They collected information about what people were saying about the quality of ruling or governing by the king. So Rajadharma is therefore an extremely important thing. Very, very important. It is something that establishes the dharma of the entire empire, people in a territory. So the king had to lead by example. A king had to lead by example. Okay, and Gandhi was somebody who studied the Dharma Shastra. He took something out of Raja Dharma when he said, be the change that you want. Okay, which basically means, he said, don't preach that, you know, the world has to change. Don't preach. What you need to do is you need to be that change yourself first and foremost. You be the change. This is a principle of Raja Dharma that Gandhi used even in the modern period, even in the 20th century. Now, if you look at Pitru Dharma, the Pitru Dharma is important for one reason. That is because the head of the family was the father. The father was the head of the family. So it was up to him. This is not patriarchy. There are also matriarchal systems, in which case it would be Matru Dharma in matriarchal societies. In otherwise, it will be Pitru Dharma. Whoever is the head of the family also has to live a dharmic life. They have to live a dharmic life so that they set an example for their family, so that they set an example for their children, so that they set an example for the extended family. Okay, so Pitru or Matru, there are both. If there are matriarchal societies, even today in Kerala and in the northeastern part of the country, like Tripura, Meghalaya and Manipur, there are matriarchal systems. where the lady is the head of the family. Okay, so there it will be called Matru Dharma. Otherwise, it will be called Pitru Dharma, which is that you have to set a good example for the rest of your family. So that is why I included it here. Just as the Raja has to set an example for the whole of the kingdom, the matriarch or the patriarch has to set a dharmic example for their children, for their families. Pautra Dharma. I have included this for another reason. Pautra Dharma is a cosmological reason. Okay? A son, by birth itself, has a duty. Okay, I spoke to you about Agni, right? I said Agni is the cleansing agent. It cleanses anything that is impure and makes it pure. According to Sanatana Dharma cosmology, when a son is born, he brings with him a fire. You know, Agni is of different varieties. I'm not going to go into all those. Okay, there is a thing called Jataragni, which is the fire that is in your stomach. Right? And this Agni that comes with the sun is basically that which he uses in order to cremate his parents. Okay, that is why it is Pautra Dharma. And a daughter does not cremate. Even in matriarchal societies, it is not a daughter who cremates. The idea of cremation is only a son's job. Okay, and actually in the good old days, as soon as a son was born, they would light up a charcoal or whatever wooden based thing, and that fire would be there, always lighted. And when the father or the mother, when they died, it was that fire that they carried with them in order to light the funeral pyre. Okay, in order to put it on the funeral pyre, and that was there. So Pautra Dharma has a special significance because it is that fire which the son is supposed to have brought with him. That is something which has a divine quality. It has a divine quality, and it is this divinity or the divine quality that led, that would free the soul, the Atman, according to the Garuda Purana, for 3 days. The soul is still roaming around for 11 days, actually, they'll say. But 3 days it is roaming around its family, according to the Garuda Purana. So if the soul has to go, then this divinely sanctioned fire has to be lit. That is why I have included Pautra Dharma. Otherwise, Dharma Shastras contain various different forms of dharma. Just remember that everything in ancient India was dharma. I'll stop here today. It says less than a minute, so it'll cut off any time.